We have before us, brothers and sisters and young people, a wonderful study over the course of this weekend, probably suggested in part, as our chairman has said, by the title. People say, well, haven't you got that the wrong way around? Shouldn't it be Saul of Gibeah? No. Saul will come into our story, of course, quite largely, actually. By the time we get to Saturday, God willing, Saul will be the centrepiece of this study, but it's not about Saul. It's about why God chose Saul to be the first king of Israel and why he chose him from Gibeah of Benjamin. There was a reason, brothers and sisters, as to why Saul came from this place. Now, how many of you over the course of the years have been doing your readings? You get to Judges chapters 17 to 21 and think, why on earth is this in the scripture? There are some absolutely appalling stories, particularly, of course, the story of the Levite's concubine and what happens to her. And then, of course, the disastrous events that overtake the nation when one tribe is almost completely wiped out of Israel. It's absolutely appalling. Why is it there? Well, the purpose of this study is to explain why we have this record here at the end of the book of Judges. Why is it put at the end, for example? Why not put it where it rightfully belongs, between verses 9 and 10 of chapter 2. That's where it belongs chronologically. Why does God put it at the end in two appendices to the book? Well, some of you probably have received the document which sets out the structure of the book of Judges. Judges chapter 1 verse 1 to 3 verse 6 is about the failure of the tribes of Israel to consolidate their inheritance. Chapters 3 verse 7 to 16 verse 31 is the history of Israel under the judges. We have six cycles of sin and recovery when God provides a saviour in the form of judges. Chapter 17, verse 1 to 21:25 are the two appendices to the book. They're just attached on the end. Well, most books have got an appendix, haven't they, at the end. So has the book of Judges. And so there's a reason for this. Chapter 17 and 18 are about the corruption of doctrine. And we're going to see that what happens here is that God's covenant is broken. And because God's covenant is broken, they do nothing about that, brothers and sisters. The following story is there to show the consequences of Israel not doing anything about the breaking of God's covenant by Micah setting up his gods and, of course, the men of Dan then establishing themselves in the north of the land with his apostate priest. More of that a little later on. So these two appendices, corruption of doctrine and corruption of practice, are there because they are fundamental to what follows in the history of the nation of Israel. And I mean that. They are fundamental. So fundamental, in fact, that when Christ was on the way to the cross and he encountered women who were weeping over him, his mind was essentially back in Judges chapter 17 to 21. Now you might think, well, that's a leap into the dark. No, it isn't. I will demonstrate that to you, God willing, over the course of the next few days. We will see that Christ's mind was back here in Judges 17 to 21. Well, there are other things about the book of Judges that really we don't have much time to talk about, but I would really like to sow a couple of ideas in your mind, seeing I'm given an extra session. Normally I've got to fit what is to you the first two studies, I've got to fit it into one. And that makes the job pretty hard. But we've got two sessions, so we can go a little bit slower. We can add one or two things that we normally wouldn't put in. The book of Judges is an inspirational book, brothers and sisters, in relation to the work of our Lord Jesus Christ. I often say, and it's true, you could just have the book of Judges and you could talk about every detail, and I mean this, every detail of the atoning work of Christ, first advent, and every detail about the second advent of Christ. Judges will also tell you about the rise, the history, and the demise of the Roman Catholic apostasy. You know that? Ever wonder when you've read Judges chapter 9, why it's such a long chapter, 58 verses or something, and it goes around and around, and you think, what do I want to know that for? It's a type of the entire history of the apostasy that arose from the brotherhood that the saints are shortly going to have the privilege of destroying. to open the eyes of men to the truth. It's all there. It's even there in terms of the timings of the conflict between that system and the two witnesses of Revelation chapter 11. If you want more detail about that, I can give you documents that will set that out for you. You can have a look at that. It is unbelievable what's in the book of Judges in terms of the work of our Lord Jesus Christ. But there's a very basic rule of thumb. I want you to come to Judges chapter 3 and the last verse of that chapter. And we read about the spectacular achievements of a man called Shamgar. But you only get one verse. Now I would love to know more about Shamgar. His feats are Samson-like. I mean, this man kills 600 enemies with an ox goad. Come on. A pointed stick. 600 men. So we read in verse 31 of Judges 3, and after him, that is after Ehud, was Shamgar the son of Anath, which slew the Philistines. Samson slew Philistines, didn't he? 600 men with an ox goad. He also delivered Israel. I would love to know more about Shamgar. Where he lived, what he did, what his background was, which you get in many other judges. Why isn't it there? Ever ask yourself that question? Why is there no information about Shamgar? Well, it's a simple rule of thumb. If there's no extended information about a judge, it is because he is not a type of Christ. Where you have a full record, like you have for Othniel, for Ehud, for Deborah and Barak, for Gideon, for Jephthah, for Samson, they're all types of our Lord Jesus Christ, every single one of them. But where you don't have much information, you don't have much information because God's not particularly interested in their history. They were not types of his son. So test that out and you'll find that what I've said to you is quite true. We have a wonderful book, this book of Judges. But we're not going to focus on any of that. We're going to focus on the last five chapters and see why they are where they are. Now, you can see from that chart, of course, we endeavour to set out the periods of time that the types in the book of Judges cover. Again, I'm not going to go into that detail. There's a 30-page document that you can get your hands on. We can pass that on to you by various means. A 30-page document which sets out all of the details of those types. So every aspect of the work of Christ, first and second advent, is covered by the types of this book. Brothers and sisters, we read in the record of Judges 2, so we're not very far away. Come back to Judges chapter 2. We read this in verse 6. Judges 2:6 says, "And when Joshua had let the people go, the children of Israel went every man unto his inheritance to possess the land. And the people, we are told in verse 7, served Yahweh all the days of Joshua, and all the days of the elders that outlived Joshua, who had seen all the great works of Yahweh that he did for Israel." In the record of verse 8 tells us that Joshua dies. Verse 9 and 10 tells us about his burial. Verse 9 says, "And they buried him in the border of his inheritance in Timnath-Heres," etc. And then verse 10 says, "And also all that generation were gathered unto their fathers, and there arose another generation after them, which knew not Yahweh, nor yet the works which he had done for Israel." We have, just as we have today, in that time, the challenge of generational change. Joshua dies. He's outlived by a number of elders. And then all that generation who had known the mighty works of their God when he brought them into the land, they pass off the scene. And there arises another generation who doesn't know anything about that history. They've not experienced it. They might have been told about it, but they don't know too much about it by experience. And it's in that generation, of course, that the wheels fall off. In fact, brothers and sisters, they fall off a little before that generation is left alone. We have the time of the miracles in the wilderness, and then we have the era of the two appendices. The two appendices that are at the end of the book of Judges actually come between verses 9 and 10 of Judges chapter 2. So if you're reading this book from a chronological perspective, when you got to the end of verse 9 of chapter 2, you need to go to chapter 17. and read to the end of chapter 21, because that's what actually happens between verses 9 and 10 of Judges 2. It's in that period when the last remnants of the elders of Israel were still there, and those who outlived Joshua. Now, how do we prove that? Well, it's pretty simple to prove. Let's come to Judges chapter 18 and verse 30. We can nail this down absolutely, and I think many of you are quite aware of this anyway, but let's nail it down that this is where the history occurs between verses 9 and 10 of chapter 2. Judges 18 verse 30 tells us about the priest that was taken by the 600 men of Dan up to the city of Laish. They captured it, of course, and they made it their own city. They called it the city of Dan, and they established Micah's apostasy, set up his idol and his apostate priest in the north, in Dan. So who was he? Well, verse 30 of Judges 18 tells us this. And the children of Dan set up the graven image, and Jonathan, the son of Gershom, the son of Manasseh, he and his sons were priests to the tribe of Dan until the day of the captivity, not of the land. It should read, to the day of the captivity of the ark. Of course, the ark was taken into captivity in the times, you remember, of Samuel. So Jonathan, the son of Gershom, the son of Manasseh. I find this extremely curious, because the name Manasseh is an interpolation. It should be Moses. Gershom was the son of Moses. And you see, the Jews, and particularly those who copied out the text, were so embarrassed by the fact that the grandson of Moses had become the first apostate priest in the setting up of idolatry in the land of Israel, that they changed it. They changed it to Manasseh. So why did they choose Manasseh of all names? Well, Manasseh means causing to forget. In other words, they chose a name that was designed to cause Israel and everybody else who read this record to forget the fact that it was the very grandson of Moses who headed up the false priesthood of the Danites in the north. How embarrassing would that be for strict Jews? Now, that's proof, isn't it? He's the grandson of Moses in that story of Judges 17 and 18. Move on with me to Judges 20 and verse 28. Now, this is the second appendix. This is the story, the terrible story of Gibeon. And what do we read? In Judges 20 and verse 28, who is here? Who's the high priest at this crisis in Israel's history? Well, verse 28 tells us, and Phinehas, the son of Eleazar, the son of Aaron, stood before the ark in those days, saying, and the question, that's all we need. All we need is the reference to the fact that Phinehas was the high priest at this time. Well, of course, he obviously comes at the early part of Israel's history in the land. He succeeds Eleazar, the high priest, when they cross the Jordan. So this is the generation that outlived Joshua, the elders who outlived him. They were on the scene when these historical events of Judges 17 to 21 unfolded. So God tucks this history right at the end of the book. And he does that for good reasons. The bulk of the book of Judges is about the work of his son, first and second advent. Judges 17 to 21 is about the history of his people who could not keep covenant. That's what it's about. And Gibeah of Saul, as you're going to come to see in this study, as we proceed, God willing, you're going to see that Gibeah represents covenants, vows, promises. It's all about covenant making and covenant breaking. And you'll see proof after proof of that as we see. So what is in these appendices? Well, I think you might have been asked, many of you would have been asked to perhaps read this section of scripture, and those of you who have done probably read it and thought, oh, that's awful. It's absolutely awful. Why would you put that stuff in there? Well, there's obviously a reason. Judges 17, we had the house of Micah who manufactures an idol and creates a false priesthood. Now look at this idiot, Micah. Come to Judges 17. Let's just take the last verse of the chapter for a start. Judges chapter 17 and Have a look with me at verse 13. Maybe verse 12. It says, Micah consecrated the Levite, this is Jonathan, the grandson of Moses. He consecrated the Levite, and the young man became his priest, and was in the house of Micah. Then said Micah, now know I that Yahweh will do me good. And he gives the reason. What's the reason? Well, seeing I have a Levite to my priest, he's an ignoramus. We call them drongos in Australia, but you use that word here? He's a drongo. You know why? Levites were not priests. Priests were Levites, but Levites were not priests. Only the sons of Aaron were priests. True? Yeah. He's got no idea. He's a feather brain, this Micah. And look at the twisted family he comes from. Come back to the early verses of Judges 17. No wonder the boy is twisted like a corkscrew, because his mother is twisted. Look what happens here in Judges 17. You got this man at Mount Ephraim, whose name was Micah in verse 1. And he said unto his mother, you know, Mum, several years back, you asked me whether or not I'd stolen your 1,100 pieces of silver, and I said, no, I hadn't. And you believe me? You were stupid. Because I did. I stole them. And she said, oh, aren't you a lovely boy? Blessed of Yahweh, my son. I know what I would have done with him. I wouldn't have been blessing him, that's for sure. See, when you twist children's minds by that kind of stupidity, don't argue when you get an outcome. Because that's the kind of outcome you get. He becomes the first creator of false idols in Israel. This man is responsible for the first great apostasy in Israel. So he comes from a twisted family. You get twisted results. Look what she does. His mother said at the end of verse 2, blessed be thou of Yahweh, my son. And when he had restored the 1,100 pieces, by the way, 11 is the biblical number for failure. And there's a lot of failure here. His mother said, I had wholly dedicated the silver unto Yahweh. So the whole 1,100 pieces will be dedicated to Yahweh. What does she do? She pockets 900 pieces of silver and puts it in her bank account and takes 200 to give it to her son to make an idol. Twisted. Got the idea of this? That's where this apostasy begins. Brothers and sisters, there's a very simple lesson in all of that. The greatest killer of Christadelphians today was the greatest killer of Christadelphians in the time of Judges. You know what it was? Ignorance. Biblical ignorance. That's why it says that every man did right in his own eyes. There was ignorance, real ignorance about what God requires. It's destroying people today as well. So that's one lesson we can learn already from Judges chapter 17 to 21. So that's the content of this chapter. We can say a lot more about that. We haven't got time to do that. Let's move on. Judges 18, a long chapter. We see the displaced Danites who couldn't take the inheritance that was given to them, seeking a place to dwell in the far north of the land. Where, of course, we are told, if you have a look at Judges chapter 18 and verse 7, this is what it says. Then the five men, the emissaries of the tribe of Dan, departed and they came to a place called Laish. And they saw the people that were therein, how they dwelt careless, after the manner of the Zidonians, quiet and secure. And there was no magistrate in the land that might put them to shame in anything. And they were far from the Sidonians and had business with no man. What a wonderful place. If you want to be a libertine, if you want to do what you please, there's no magistrate, there's no arranging brethren to tell you, no, I can't do that. There's nobody saying, no, that's not scriptural. No policeman. Wow, this is terrific. Let's start an ecclesia here. Yeah, that's what they did. So they took this place. These loose people who wanted to be able to do as they pleased, set up their own idolatry, their own priesthood, did it as they pleased to do it. That's what's happening here, brothers and sisters. That all comes. It all comes out of what happened in the house of Micah and what was happening in the tribe of Dan. For these displaced Danites, they seek this place and establish their apostasy with Jonathan, the grandson of Moses, as their priest. Then we come to Judges 19. A Levite retrieves his wayward concubine, only to lose her, of course, at the hands of brutal Sodomites in Gibeah of Benjamin. I'm not even going to read that history out to you, brothers and sisters. It's awful. I mean, the world today would be embarrassed, wouldn't they, by what you read in Judges chapter 19. And there's a lot of awful things going on in our world. But it's there for a reason. In Judges 20, indignant but hypocritical Israel, who did absolutely zero about the problem in the north, in Dan, ended up suffering dreadfully themselves. They came to cleanse Benjamin of moral impurity while they themselves had done nothing about apostasy in their own ranks. God will not tolerate hypocrisy. If there's one thing he hates, it's hypocrisy. He will make you pay for it. And in Judges 21, they do pay for it. Israel in a quandary, having destroyed the tribe of Benjamin at the end of chapter 20, are in a quandary because they've made oaths. They've made promises. They've made vows. And they said, none of us will give our daughters to any survivors of Benjamin. And if anybody hasn't sent people to be involved in this conflict, then we will go and destroy that city. And they did, the city of Jabesh-Gilead. Remember that? So they made covenants and oaths, and then they found themselves in a very difficult situation. They had to find a way around them. You know, they had to sneak around the promise, the vow that they made, that they would not give their daughters. So what did they do? You know the story. They say to the 200 men who have Benjamites, who don't have wives, just sit quietly and wait. You wait until an appropriate time, then run out and grab one of the daughters of Israel and run off with her. Mum and Dad would be very happy about that. That's how they got around that oath. That's the kind of spirit that was here, brothers and sisters. There was no king in Israel. You've wondered why that statement is made four times in five chapters? You find it in chapter 17, verse 6. It's there again in chapter 18, verse 1. 19, verse 1. Chapter 21, verse 25. There was no king. Well, it was obvious. There was no normal mortal king like the nations had, yeah. But there wasn't even a heavenly king either. Yahweh was not regarded as a king by his people. And this begins the story of Gibeah of Saul. Because when the day came that Israel, in the days of Samuel, demanded a king, guess where God gets him from? Gibeah of Benjamin. Where these awful things happen in Judges 19 to 21. You reckon that was deliberate? Of course it was deliberate. Why did he do it? I'll give you a little clue. What was the leading, I'll ask you a question. What was the leading characteristic of Saul, the first king of Israel? Well, I'll tell you what it was. He couldn't keep a promise to help himself. Every oath, every covenant that he made, bar one, he broke. Anyone know what vow that he made he didn't break? You can answer it. Anyone know? The oath that he made to the witch of Endor. And you know why he didn't break that one? He was dead the next day. He didn't have time. He could not keep a promise to help himself. Every vow he made to David, to Jonathan, he broke. So that is why God chose Israel's first king from Gibeah of Benjamin. Because Gibeah of Benjamin was all about making and breaking covenants and vows and oaths. And we're going to see that as we proceed. Well, That's where we're heading in our study, primarily. But let's have a look at this statement. Have a look with me, if you would, at the very last verse of Judges. Judges 21 and verse 25. And there we read, in those days there was no king in Israel. We've sort of seen part of the reason for that. We'll see more. Every man did that which was right in his own eyes. Now, you're all aware, of course, that where you see italicized words in the King James Version, it is because there is no equivalent in the Hebrew. The translators have put those words in. So you can quite justly wipe out the italicized words. So take this phrase, every man did that which was right in his own eyes, drop out the italicized words, and what have you got? Every man did right in his own eyes. You see, the word right there means straight. They did what they thought was straight in their own. This is talking not about a generation who just do what they please. Well, we live in a world like that. Just do it. You know, whatever you want to do, do it. That's not what this is saying, brothers and sisters. This is saying that here you have a people who do the wrong thing, and they know it's the wrong thing, but they justify it. They find a way of justifying their behaviour. Now, we wouldn't be living in a world like that, would we? This world can justify almost anything. And it's an unfortunate but sad fact, very sad fact, that we're seeing this creeping in to our own community. When men set their own standards, invariably God is left out. Humanism puts man before God. Humanism can justify anything. That was the spirit of the times of Judges. It's the spirit of the age which we live. Let me just read out to you a brother's lament in 2011. He wrote, "We are currently in the golden age of sin. Right is wrong, and wrong is right. The only real sin today is talking about sin. We have the perfect storm of humanism, evolution, and moral relativity in society around us. This has eroded our standards and brought about a moral and doctrinal laxity in our ecclesias. In an honest effort to become more loving and kind, we are now threatened by a dynamic of extreme tolerance. In that climate, the tolerant stand idle as people simply do as they please, but swiftly condemn anyone who judges doctrine and behaviour according to biblical standards." He's not far off the mark, brothers and sisters. That is the age, the time in which we live. You know, when decline occurs, it rarely occurs like that. It doesn't just plunge off the edge of a cliff and go straight down. Decline in a large community doesn't happen like that, except in the final stages before God's exhausted and divine judgment comes. It's more like that, isn't it? It's just this gradual lowering, you know, just lowering. A bit like Christchurch sort of was lowered about a metre, wasn't it, a few years ago? Just a little bit of lowering of standards and practices and things that were once accepted as normal. Biblical standards, they go. Well, we'll talk a bit more about that in a minute. When you look at the book of Judges, the tribes had failed. They had largely failed to take their inheritance. So you see these red lines on this. This indicates probably, approximately, where the tribes had actually conquered the land. There was a large swathe out here, for example, that was given to the tribe of Dan. They never conquered it. You might recall that Ephraim and Manasseh complained. Ephraim particularly complains in the book of Joshua about, we weren't given enough land. Take a look at what was apportioned to them. The problem was that the people on the plains, the Canaanites, had chariots of iron. I think, well, we can't beat them. So they wanted more territory. Joshua, of course, sends them away and says, come on, you were given the territory. The problem is lack of faith. Go out and take it. And they didn't. There was compromise. And that compromise is set out for us. If you come back to Judges chapter 1, well, let's see what happened here. Judges chapter 1, verses 22 to 26. Now, this is a terrible chapter because it sets out there's failure. And as you read on, it gets worse and worse and worse. And the leading tribes are responsible for this because they're not giving an example to be followed by the lesser tribes. And here's one of them, the house of Joseph, verse 22 of Judges chapter 1. And the house of Joseph, they also went up against Bethel, the house of God. And Yahweh was with them. And the house of Joseph sent to describe Bethel. That is, they wanted to check it over first. Verse 24. And the spies saw a man come forth out of the city, and they said unto him, show us, we pray thee, the entrance into the city, and we will show thee mercy. Now there's your first trouble. There's your first problem. That was totally forbidden. We're going to see that in a minute. Verse 25. And when he showed them the entrance of the city, they smote the city with the edge of the sword. But they let go the man and all his family. And the man went into the land of the Hittites and built a city and called the name thereof Luz. So he comes from Luz, which was named Bethel, caused by Jacob. So he goes away, he builds another city and calls it Luz in the land of the Hittites. I wonder how much trouble he caused Israel thereafter. And here's descendants, probably a lot, because he shouldn't have been there. He shouldn't have been alive. Now, of course, the humanists will say, but well, he played his part. He played his part. But he was asked, how do we get the city? And he said, well, this is, you do this, you do that. Well, then you can't kill this man, can't you? Let's have a look at Deuteronomy chapter 20. You know, we hear things like, well, God wouldn't let that happen. I'm surely that's not the way God works. Well, this is what God wanted of Israel, brothers and sisters. Very plain. Deuteronomy 20, verse 16. But of the cities of these people, which Yahweh thy God doth give thee for an inheritance, thou shalt save alive nothing that breatheth. But thou shalt utterly destroy them, namely the Hittites. Isn't that interesting? That's the first one. That's where he went, to the land of the Hittites. The Hittites, and it goes on to describe the Amorites, the Canaanites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, the Jebusites, as Yahweh thy God has commanded thee, that they teach you not to do after all of their abominations. So there was an inflexible rule for Israel. When you come into this land, when you come to take a city, you will kill every person therein. Now that goes down like a lead balloon in the modern world. But that was what God required. He had forewarned Israel that they would need to be patient. And we're going to take the city in one day. It's a bit like you and I dealing with human nature, brother. And said, you don't beat it in a day, do you? You do not beat human nature in a day. It's a lifetime process. It would take them a long time to conquer all these cities. They just had to persist until they destroyed it. And of course, the whole purpose of the truth is ultimately to do what Christ did. Put flesh out of existence. Yeah. To crucify it with its affections and lusts. That's the principle behind this. It takes time. You've got to be patient. You've got to work at that. And the house of Joseph traded the divine imperative, the clear law, for the path of convenience. The house of God, Bethel, is not established by compromise. Jeroboam the first was to discover that, brothers and sisters, when he put his golden calf in Bethel. The house of God is not established by compromise. The Canaanites prospered to the future detriment of Israel. And Judges 2:3 tells us about that. It says this, and ye shall make no league with the inhabitants of this land. Ye shall throw down their altars, but ye have not obeyed my voice. Why have you done this, says God? Wherefore I also said, I will not drive them out from before you, but they shall be as thorns in your sides, and their gods shall be a snare unto you. That's exactly what happened. In Joshua 23, verse 13, there's a similar statement made, with a slight variation here and there. It says this, Joshua warned Israel, "Know for a certainty that Yahweh your God will no more drive out any of these nations from before you, but they shall be snares and traps unto you, and scourges in your sides, and thorns in your eyes." Well, thorns in your eyes? "Until you perish from off this good land which Yahweh your God has given you." So there was the challenge of association, because they did not do what God required. They left the Canaanites. So what was God going to do about this? He was angry. He sent an angel in Judges chapter 2 to Bochim, which means weeping. And he rebuked his people for not obeying him. So then, because they would not remove the Canaanites, that problem has to be dealt with. What do you do then? Well, that's what Judges 3, verses 1 and 2 are all about. So come with me to Judges chapter 3. If they won't remove them, then he's going to use those remaining Canaanites as a test to prove Israel. So Judges chapter 3 and verse 1, we read this. "Now these are the nations which Yahweh left to prove Israel by them, even as many of Israel as had not known all the walls of Canaan." What's that telling you? Well, this was very important for those who had not experienced warfare in taking their inheritance. You know, it's often said, isn't it, that those who had to really fight and struggle in the war years, the Second World War years and the 1950s when life was difficult, it's often said that they came through that experience mature and developed. We, the generation of the latter portion of the 20th century and the early part of the 21st century, have lived basically at ease, really, in many ways, at ease, in prosperity. We haven't experienced the difficulties both in the ecclesia and in the world that our parents and grandparents did. I think probably the result was better in their case. And so God is going to prove Israel, and he's going to lead these Canaanites there so that people will come to understand that they need to fight. They need to go to warfare. That's our position exactly. Every individual must be tested in the warfare of faith. And look, I'll say this now, brothers and sisters, as I travel around, the one thing I'm finding is that a lot of our people are being seriously tested right now. I know, you know, that Christ is not far away. You know what I say to these people? What do you say to them when they're crying on your shoulder? What do you say to them? Well, I say to them that that's the way. That's the way that God is testing them. So whether or not they're going to remain firm under great challenges, and the end result will be good, providing they persist, providing they hold to the things that they know to be right. That, brothers and sisters, is what's happening to many of our people right now. And I tell them this, the last thing I say to them is this, brothers and sisters, why shouldn't we be tested? We, the prosperous generation, who have had it so easy for decades, living in this world that's got everything that opens and shuts, peaceful. Nobody challenges us, do they? We're not persecuted. Why should we get in the kingdom in an armchair? Why shouldn't we be tested? We are being tested. Very subtly, very often, but we are being tested. And the test for this generation back in Judges comes from being associated, like it does in many of our cases, by the necessity and life circumstances in which we find ourselves, with different types of people. Neighbours, work colleagues, unbelieving relatives, acquaintances, etc. A minority may be hostile, but the vast majority will be desirous of peace and friendship. So I want you to look with me at the following verses in Judges 3, verses 3 and 4. Because these are the nations that God left to prove Israel. And they're listed for us in verse 3. Namely, five lords of the Philistines, and all the Canaanites, and the Sidonians, and the Hivites. Verse 4 says, and they were to prove Israel by them, to know whether they would hearken unto the commandments of Yahweh, which he commanded their fathers by the hand of Moses. Well, who are these people? Well, the Philistines were the only aggressive people of the four that are listed. Their name, of course, means to roll in the dust. They're out there. They don't care what the world thinks. They're the uncircumcised Philistines. They will live their life as they please and don't get in their way. They're aggressive people. They're ready to fight to protect their interests, and they'll deliver retribution if necessary. There are a few around like that, aren't there? There are people like that in our world. But then you've got the Canaanite. The very word means to bend the knee, to humiliate. You know, and it's used, as you well know, of a merchant or a trader. And he will come up and put that around his knee and say, I've got the best snake oil that you've ever seen. All right? And try and sell you something. So, that, you know, they've got a policy of peace through compromise and accommodation. That's the Canaanite. We meet a few of them in our time, don't we? Then there's the Zidonians, which means to lie in wait to hunt. This is the permissive, free society, the immoral society, luring the unwary through immorality and base behaviour. Would anybody disagree that the world we live in is filled with those kinds of people? These are the people who run the internet sites that 70% of the internet's about. Do I need to say what it's about? 70% of the internet is run by these people. Zidonians lying in wait to deceive. And the young are particularly vulnerable. Not that the old are outside the danger of risk either. And there's the Hivites. Hivites, of course, this was the men of Shechem. What did the men of Shechem do in Genesis 34? They did exactly this. Their name means a villager. They just want to be left alone. They promoted prosperity and peace through intermarriage. Why don't we just all be one big happy family? Why do we have to argue? That's this kind of people. They do it through trade and compromise. They represent, of course, the corrupt, materialistic society that just wants to be left alone to do what they please. And Israel is going to be proved by them. And we know what happened, don't we? We know what happened. This is the anatomy of ecclesial decline. It goes from strength like it was in the days of Joshua and some of the elders who outlived him. And these minor changes that were made after his death. He didn't get away with too much while he was alive. But the minor changes eventually led to major change of direction of that people. And the change then occurs more easily and decline becomes more rapid. And so it falls away the further it comes down the track. So when resolve is weakened, and when unwise and ill-conceived decisions to change direction are made, then this is what happens to a community. That's what happened in the days of Judges. And moreover, they could justify it. Every man did right in his own eyes. So don't go along and challenge them, because they'll have a barrel full of answers as to why what they're doing is okay, even if it's diametrically opposed to Scripture. That's what happens. So why, then, do we have six cycles of failure and redemption? Exactly for that reason. There are six cycles of failure and redemption in the history of Israel for 450-odd years in the days of the Judges. And, of course, in Sunday school, you learn that statement that sin brings suffering and seeking God brings salvation. And there it is laid out in the Judges. Sin, down through their history, they served Balaam in Judges 3. They did evil in Judges 3:12. Did evil in 4:1, 6:1, 10:6, 13:1. And when they suffer through Cushan Rishathaim, Eglon, the fat man of Moab, Jabin and Sisera, the Midianites, the Ammonites and the Philistines, and they cried out to Yahweh, except for Judges 10, he answered them every time by raising up a judge to save them. And the judges of Israel, of course, were rare characters. There weren't many like this. And God selected one here and one there that he might redeem his people for a short time until the cycles of sin took over again. The word judges, shofetim, actually means rulers, from the verb to put right and then rule. Every man was doing right in his own eyes. So God says, here, let's put it right. And he raised up a judge. Now there were 13 judges. In the book of Judges, 12 were called by God, and there was one imposter. His name was Abimelech. And he, of course, is the type of the Roman Catholic system. Abimelech, his very name, Father King. That's Papa. That's the Pope. A Father King. Okay? And the entire history, as I said, of the Roman Catholic system, which arose out of the Brotherhood, is there at the end of Judges 8 and through Judges 9. Now, these 12 faithful judges, called by God, of course, amongst other things, foreshadowed the 12 faithful apostles. And there was one impostor among them as well, wasn't there? Who had to be replaced. Yeah, his name was Judas Iscariot. More importantly, of course, it foreshadowed the rise of the papacy, as I said. So the story of Abimelech, who represents the man of sin. You know where he comes in the scheme of things? Chronologically, where Abimelech comes? He's number 6. He's an imposter. He's a self-appointed judge. But in the chronology, he happens to be number 6. 6, the number of man. 666. There is a precision here, which is really modern. So Yahweh raised them up judges, brothers and sisters. And what faithful men and women are listed there on the left-hand side of that list of judges of Israel. They didn't, of course, have rule over the whole land. As you can see, and this is obviously has to be approximate, we don't know exactly where every judge judged, but what we do know is this. They were raised up in local areas where the problems existed. And they didn't always have influence over the whole nation. So, for example, Jephthah, he dealt with the men of Ephraim who lived over this side of Jordan, as we well know in Judges 12, but he didn't have any influence over the rest of the tribes. And so it was for most of these judges. They were effective in the area where they lived. And that's the way it is, isn't it? That's the way it is today. What effect do I have on your ecclesia? Zero. True? Zero. I've got some effect on my own ecclesia, to a small degree. So if you're going to do anything, brothers and sisters, it's done largely in your local area. And God raises up one here and one there when problems arise. He's looking for people like that. This is why there was so much confusion in Israel, because you had one area going all right and another area going terrible. Now, let's finish off this tonight by looking at a couple of very important things. Scripture is a wonderful thing, isn't it? If I was writing this story, it would be totally different. Totally different. Because what would interest me would be big things, you know? God wouldn't do that. This is why Bethlehem, Judah is prominent in both the stories that end the book of Judges. Now, Bethlehem, Judah means the house of bread and praise. It occurs 7 times in the 5 chapters, Judges 17 to 21. 7 times? What's 7 commandments? Covenant. Yeah. Now, would you put Bethlehem, Judah in this record? Well, we know what it says in Micah chapter 5 and verse 2. We're told in Micah chapter 5 verse 2 that if you did a census of the tribe of Judah, you probably wouldn't even bother putting Bethlehem in it. It's too small, too insignificant to even be counted, says Judges, Micah 5 verse 2. You wouldn't even bother putting it in. So why does it end up 7 times in this story? Well, Jonathan, the grandson of Moses, sojourned for a time in Bethlehem, Judah, but he was a footloose Levite. Under-occupied, and he was ignorant. He was also ambitious. So when he arrived at the house of Micah, he took on a job and became the priest of the first apostasy in Israel. The Levite's wayward concubine, who meets a terrible end in Gibeah of Benjamin, came from Bethlehem, Judah. Record of Judges 19, verses 1 to 2. So why? Well, a couple of suggestions. To show the condition of all Israel, yes, take this very insignificant place, it's like a microcosm of the whole nation. And secondly, to contrast with another family that came from Bethlehem, Judah. Yeah, Boaz and Ruth, who bring forth the Father, the fathers of our Lord Jesus Christ. Yeah, see, totally insignificant and yet prominent in the stories that end Judges and, of course, in the rest of the Bible. So what does things, isn't it? So Micah 5 verse 2 says, "But thou, Bethlehem Ephratah, though thou be little among the thousands of Judah, yet out of thee shall he come forth unto me, that is to be ruler, the one that will have dominion in Israel, whose goings forth," as the Hebrew word means, "his family descent, have been from old, from everlasting." He was always in the mind of God. He's going to be brought out of the insignificant place. Israel's first king, as we said earlier, was from Gibeah. Why? Well, the events of Gibeah provide the basis for the ultimate selection of Israel's first king from that place. And the disaster that occurs there, which we'll consider tomorrow night, God willing, brothers and sisters, emanated from the establishment by 600 men from the tribe of Dan of the first idolatrous apostasy in Israel. Do I need to remind you that when the disaster of Judges 20 had ended, there were how many people left in Benjamin? 600 men. That might be a little bit more than coincidence, eh? Yahweh's covenant was broken, and Gibeah is all about making and breaking of covenants, and so as we've said, Saul. So let's just very briefly consider what happened here in Judges chapter 18. Dan, second largest tribe, in fact, of Israel, was unable to secure their inheritance. 600 of them migrate north and they capture Laish. Judges 18, verse 11, 27, 28, tell us about that story. The remainder of Dan are forced onto the heights between Zoar and Eshtaol, and guess who arises from there in Judges chapter 13? Yeah, Samson, the last recorded judge in the book of Judges. So here we've got, brothers and sisters, this terrible story that leads to this apostasy. So I want to conclude tonight on this matter of the breaking of God's covenant. Let me just put that passage up before you, but come back with me to the reading from a couple of days ago in Deuteronomy 27. In Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 23, God said this to Israel, as we've got on the screen. And I'd like you to be with me in Deuteronomy 27. He said in chapter 4, 23, "Take heed unto yourselves," through Moses, of course, "lest ye forget the covenant of Yahweh your God, which he made with you, and make a graven image, or the likeness of anything which Yahweh thy God hath forbidden thee. For he is a consuming fire, even a jealous God." Micah was the first recorded man to make a graven image of Israel. And of course, the story of Judges 17 and 18 we've very briefly reviewed. There was Micah's home near Mount Ephraim. Of course, here's Bethlehem, Judah. You have the footloose Jonathan, grandson of Moses, who comes up here. He gets a job. Then you've got the five ambassadors of Dan who eventually bring their 600 up to Laish, way up in the north. And on the way, of course, they've basically got to go past the door of Micah. So they take Jonathan, the grandson of Moses, and Micah's in. He's not very happy about it, of course. But they take it and they establish this apostasy up in the north, the first idolatrous apostasy in Israel. So you're in Deuteronomy 27? Would you have a look with me at verses 11 to 15? "And Moses charged the people the same day, saying," so where are they? Well, he's telling them they're going to be, eventually, after the defeat of Ai, they're going to be up at Shechem. All right, they're going to go to Shechem. And he tells them this in verse 12. "These shall stand upon Mount Gerizim," which is to the south, "to bless the people when you come over Jordan. Simeon and Levi and Judah and Issachar and Joseph and Benjamin. And these shall stand upon Mount Ebal," which by the way is to the north, "to curse." Who's there? "Reuben, Gad and Asher and Zebulun." Dan and Naphtali. "And the Levites," verse 14, "shall speak and say unto all the men of Israel with a loud voice, What's the very first thing that they're going to say? Shouting across the valley. All right, you've got the half the tribes on one mountain and half on the other. You've been there, you know you can actually shout across the valley, even with the traffic noise. You can shout across the valley. So what's the very first thing? Verse 15. Cursed be the man that maketh any graven or molten image. An abomination unto Yahweh of the work of the hands of the craftsman. And putteth it in a secret place. You could not get a more accurate description than what happened in the house of Moloch. And then Dan, who stood on the mount of cursing and said, at the end of that verse, Amen! Dan comes along, takes up the image and the priest. How consistent is human nature, brothers and sisters? So what should have been done by the tribes of Israel when this happened? You're in Deuteronomy, come back to chapter 13. What should have been done? Verse 12. If thou should hear say in one of thy cities, which Yahweh thy God have given thee to dwell there, saying, certain men, the children of Belial, are gone out from among you, and have withdrawn the inhabitants of their city, saying, let us go and serve other gods, which ye have not known. Well, the intent of the 600 men of Dan is clearly foreshadowed in verse 13, isn't it? What about verse 14? Then thou should inquire and make search and ask diligently, and behold, if it be truth, and the thing certain that such abomination is wrought among you. So what should have Israel have done when they heard about this apostasy in the north? Make diligent inquiry. Did they? No. Nothing was done. What about verse 15? Thou should surely smite the inhabitants of that city with the edge of the sword, destroying it utterly, and all that is therein, the cattle thereof, with the edge of the sword. You know what happened? They did nothing about Dan, but that's exactly what happened to Benjamin. They destroyed all the cities, every person, men, women, children, every animal. It was just 600 males of Benjamin who survived. Then verse 16. And thou shalt gather all the spoil of it in the midst of the street thereof, and shall burn with fire the city, and all the spoil thereof every whit, for Yahweh thy God, and it shall be a heap forever. That's what should have happened to Dan in the north. It didn't. And in Judges chapter 20, guess who turns up to deal with the problems of the men of Gibeah? You got it in one. 600 men from Dan in the north. No wonder God does what he does to Israel, brothers and sisters. He hates hypocrisy. And we're going to see tomorrow night, God, what he does in the days of Gibeah.